Thank you. will remember Christ's eternal authority over the world, as it is the only kind of authority that is not temporal and fleeting. Christ the King Sunday is the very last Sunday on the calendar of the Christian year. The Christian year starts next Sunday with the beginning of the season of Advent. Elder Barbara D'Angelo will be leading our worship service today. Some of the events this week are: today the deacons will be decorating the church for Christmas, and they need your help. They will meet at the church this afternoon at 1:30 p.m. Please come lend a hand and bring a friend. The deacons sure will appreciate it. The prayer group meets in the session house on Monday mornings at 9. Come and join others in prayer. All are welcome. It is a wonderful way to begin the day and start the week. If you are interested in joining the choir, rehearsals are on Thursdays at 3 p.m. Bell rehearsals are held Sunday mornings after the worship service. Come and make a joyful noise. Speak with Jane or any of the choir or bell members for more information. The Sunday School needs teachers for 4-week blocks in January, February, and March. Please consider being a part of this most important mission, our children. Contact Elena Leandro or Ian Borsak for more information. The Children's Christmas Budget is December 18th. Practices will be during Sunday School starting December 4th. All ages are welcome. Jane Hasty would like to assemble a children's choir. Interested? Reach out to Jane so she can start coordinating rehearsal days and times. For more information about our church of this, please check out the news from the pews, our website, or the church Facebook page. The food pantry item of the week is canned meat. Are there any other announcements from the congregation? Don Smith will now share a minute from Michigan.
Being wrapped in simple white tissue paper, no gift, giver or recipient is more important to better or better than anyone else. This year, we've been asked to give warm hats and waterproof gloves. Please don't give knit gloves, because when they get wet, you don't dry. This is especially important when you're living outside. While shopping, please pick up a hat and a pair of waterproof gloves. Wrap them in plain white paper. Label them as to size and whether they are for a woman or a man. Bring your white gifts to church on Sunday, December the 18th. They will be collected by the children and brought forward to be laid and before the Christ Child manger, to be covered in our love and prayers. The mission team will deliver them to the center of Riverhead the following day. Then our hope for a better life will be shared. Let's give joy.
Thank you. wonderful thing, and we should really appreciate our technicians. So thank you so much. If we say we have no sin, we are only fooling ourselves. Let us pray together. Jesus Christ,
Son of God, forgive the time we have robbed you, the times we have turned away from you, the times we have laughed at you, the times we have ignored you, and the needs of our brothers and sisters. Bring us close once more, that we might dwell in your redeeming love. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Now let us bring those thoughts to ourselves in a moment of silent confession. Jesus said, Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. Brothers and sisters, siblings in Christ, rejoice, for Christ's love and forgiveness is for you. Amen. Now, it's time to pass the peace, remembering that we are all brothers and sisters in Christ. So let us rise together and greet one another and be full of joy. So Jesus said, peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. So let us stand and share with our neighbors the peace of Christ as given to you. And may the peace of Christ be with you always.
verses 28 to 31. Listen to the word of God. Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary and increases the stable, increasing the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The New Testament lesson is taken from Romans 15, 13. Listen to the word of God. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit you may abound in hope. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Now may the Lord touch my lips and bless my words. Amen. We open today's service with the hymn, "There's a Sweet, Sweet Spirit in This Place." I certainly can feel the Spirit, especially when the light shines through these tremendous windows. When you see the sun pouring down and the dust particles prancing in the air like the stars do in the heavens, you want to dance with them like David around the ark. When the sun is bright, it can be blinding, like looking into the face of God. But still, you look even if it is with eyes closed, because you feel God's presence and love. At one time, I wondered why this church didn't have beautiful stained glass windows like most of the other Presbyterian churches on Long Island. I was told that this church doesn't shut itself off from the world, that we let our light shine out as much as the outside shines in. But that light outside can sometimes be overwhelming, especially when it turns to darkness and saps you everything, including hope. I've been to both places, floating with the sunbeams and crushed by worldly cares. But what is harder is when you see others in that darkness and can't help them out of it. I'm speaking of my mission work in Cuba. The Cuban people struggle with simple survival, chronic blackouts, access or no food, no medicine, and no hope of improvement. How do you live when there is no hope? These words keep repeating themselves over and over in my mind. How did Moses give hope to the people who followed him through the desert? They didn't know that their journeys would actually end in the desert. Moses knew. It was also his fate. The future was for the next generation. In Cuba, the next generation has come, and they are already old, dead, or gone. The revolution was in 1959. How many generations do you get out of 63 years? Two? Three? I was reading George Orwell's book, 1984, The Story of Big Brother. I didn't put it down. It gave me nightmares. I saw too much of it in today's world, not just in the oppressed countries, but also in our own country, the United States. I read 1984 in high school, but that was too many generations ago. Of course, no one ever forgets Big Brother. But the one of the things I didn't remember was the program of 2 minutes of hate, where everyone sat in front of a telly screen and screamed in anger for 2 minutes, building up into a rage,
It was like a coffee break and went over. Everyone went back to work as though nothing had happened. The protagonist, Winston Smith, said everyone emoted in an extreme, lest they be considered counter-revolutionaries for lack of enthusiasm. Counter-revolutionaries were shot. He also added, the horrible thing about the 2 minutes of hate was not that one was obliged to act a part, but that it was impossible to avoid joining in. Within 30 seconds, any pretense was always unnecessary. Everything seems so extreme now. In this country, we waited for the election that took place a few weeks ago. In Cuba, the only waiting that seems to be happening is standing in line to get food or fuel. A wait that is usually more wishful thinking than actuality. Except there is another line. It extends out of the country, over the ocean, and deposits people on foreign borders with Cubans hoping another country will let them in. More Cubans have left Cuba in the past year than had left during the 1980 Mariel boat lift. How sad. In Guinness alone, many of the young people are gone. Young adults I have watched grow in the church over the last 28 years, gone. Somehow they manage to cobble together the thousands of dollars it takes to get a flight out and passage through the conductor. Our dear sister Clarita, who has helped care for us while we are in Guinness, is now weeping for joy, while at the same time weeping for the loss of her daughter, who has just made the crossing and is waiting for her extended family in Miami to claim her. Jorge Luis, who recently completed his studies at the Cuban Seminary in Matanzas with his wife and daughter, were on their way when I began writing these words a week ago. They have arrived in the States. Every day, someone else pops up in Miami. Those they've left behind, mothers, fathers, grandparents, try to remain strong, believing they had to lose their children in order for their children to live happy lives. What they had been looking at were children with hollow eyes. The young people remaining in Cuba have lost all hope. I used to pray that the young people would stay and become leaders in their society. Now it's kind of like being one of the Hebrews who remained in Egypt after the Exodus had left. They were safe, but they were still slaves. This must be how Lazaro feels. He saved for years to build a second floor apartment on his house for his sons. He proudly showed us the construction project on our last visit to Guinness this past April, work that he and his son had done together. One son was already gone. Lazaro had hoped to keep his family together with the lure of home. His second son is now gone. He left on the Exodus and is in Miami. Once they had been a three-generation family living in a tiny house with two bedrooms. All that is left is ancient, blind grandmother Olga, Lazaro and his wife Hilda, in a house that is now too big, all weeping tears of joy and sorrow. Pastor Abel's sons are about to make a journey. They are scheduled to leave today at 11:45. I wrote to Abel expressing my concern for him and his wife Sarah. I don't know how I would feel giving up my family and being left behind only with hope. Abel wrote to me, millions of Cubans bear these marks of suffering. We don't know how Sarah and I can bear this. It's as if our lives or a large part have been taken from us. On the other hand, seeing our sons here sad, without hope, with their gaze lost on the horizon, is a double suffering. If they achieve this dream, it will be the only incentive we have left from this bitter separation. Looking at the church piano, which David played every Sunday, will be impossible for me. On the other hand, the hope of seeing each other later also calms our spirits. Pray a lot for us and help our children in everything. That will content our souls and leave us that ray of light that it was not in vain. Thank you for your words. I think you know what is happening to us. You have seen it many times in the life stories of this town. I want to be more uplifting, but right now the path is being lit by a very small candle and the wind is blowing. I was in a conversation with a group of women recently. I proposed a question: how to remain hopeful? It was a more personal than rhetorical question. I was doing research for my sermon. It is so easy to become lost in despair. We shared personal stories. One woman, who had been an oncologist nurse, said that people always questioned her about how she could work in such a field. Wasn't it depressing and demoralizing? She said no, and added the most hopeful people she cared for were the dying. They didn't have false hopes of miracle cures. Their hopes were small hopes. They hoped to see a loved one to say goodbye. They hoped to watch the sunrise one more time. Many were people of faith. Their hearts were filled and they were at peace. The nurse said it was transformative. There's a power in hope, even when it is letting go. Isn't there a saying? Let go, let God. The psalmist asked, why are you cast down, O my soul, and why are you in turmoil within me? Immediately answering himself, hope in God. The stories grew darker and darker. A friend shared that she couldn't return to visit her family in Venezuela, where she had been born because of the violence and chaos. She told about how her grandfather had escaped Franco's Spain to get to Venezuela. His three brothers had been executed for having been on the wrong side politically. He would have been killed too, but he was able to escape Spain. Now his family cannot return to Venezuela. My friend's name is Esperanza, which means hope. She said without her grandfather's hope, she would not have come to the United States. She added, hope and love go hand in hand. We're never alone when we have faith. Despair is something we can inflict upon ourselves, and it's usually when we've lost sight of God. Despair is when you're given up. There were some tears as we talked. Some were silent, taking in the pain and lining it up next to their own. But as we spoke, there was a shift in the dynamics and some light came into the conversation. I said, you know what I believe is the essence of hope? It's the Holy Spirit. When you feel the presence of God, it washes over you and fills you like rain pouring into an empty barrel. This is what keeps the Cuban people of faith going. And I guess, I know it's what keeps all of us going. It's that sweet, sweet spirit. I've been traveling to Cuba annually since 1994. I've thought of the visits as missions of hope. The Cuban people were so isolated after the revolution. My team brought hope. Hope that our countries would begin diplomatic relations. Hope that the material gifts we carry would make their lives a little better. Hope in the knowledge that we care. Returning every year, we have become family. With the opening of the internet and access to cell phones, they have proof of how repressed their lives are. Now I feel like my hands are empty. Now we must lean on God, and like the book of Isaiah says, but those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. But where are we to soar? I don't know. I will continue to return to Cuba, praying for a miracle and believing in hope. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit, you may abound in hope, because the light of God never burns out. Amen. And all those who are able, please stand and let us sing hymn number 353, My Hope is Built on Nothing Less.
Are there any prayers from the congregation?
repeat a prayer that you set out this week regarding joy, which is out of my west end. Joyce Walker. She's back home next week.
Yes, Joyce is going to be coming home on Wednesday. So it's been a long journey, but she's triumphant. Are there any other prayers? So we're asking for prayers for Marion Dionge, who is having difficulty getting located and having support for her. They're in the West Hampton Care Center now. They're neighbors of choice. Wendy's asking for prayers for the family of John Mavis.
John Novus. Novus.
Novus. Who suddenly passed away and was only 60 years old, you said? Are there any other prayers? All right, let us pray. The Lord is nigh unto all who call upon Him, to all who call upon Him in truth. As we prepare to bring our hearts and minds to God, listen to these words from yesterday's devotional from the Cuban Church. How nice it would be if we all saw the light instead of the shadows. This helps me think about how wonderful life is. Sometimes we forget about the blessings we receive and always think about the adversities we face day by day. We are prone to remember illnesses, financial problems, and worries. God is merciful and showers upon us His blessings, even though they may be little recognized. Think, for example, of the beauty of a flower, a tree with its fruit, the smile of a child. Why do we insist on looking at the shadows? Seek blessings, acknowledge them, and enjoy each one. Loving God, we lay before You our trials and our cares. We ask that You bless us and relieve us of our many burdens. We pray for the sick, the lost, and the lonely. We We ask for comfort for those in sadness, especially this week of Thanksgiving, when most of us will be with family and friends. We know there are some who believe they have no one. Help us to become their friends. We pray for peace in our homes, villages, states, country, and around the world. Peace seems so elusive. Please bring it into the hearts of those who have lost it. We pray for our Earth, this amazing planet you've given to us. Help us to be better stewards and nurturing of her. We pray for our church. We are in transition and it is difficult. It's so hard to wait not knowing. Help us to trust in our pastor nominating committee and trust that they are always there guiding them to the pastor you have already chosen for us. Please bless the people of our sister church in Cuba, La Iglesia Presbiteriana and Winnis. Give comfort to their pastor, Abel Mirabal, and his wife, Sarah. We thank you for loving us even when we don't love ourselves. Most of all, thank you for the gift of your son, Jesus. Also, please, Lord, remember the family of John Knowles, who suddenly passed away. Be with Jane's brother, John, who is just coming out of surgery. Comfort and strengthen the Rorick family. Be with Marianne DeAnge as she deals what it is like to grow old. And bless Joyce, and may she dance out of the care center on Wednesday and be welcomed by her family for her Thanksgiving dinner. And now, dear Lord, let us pray as our dear Lord Jesus taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
The God who shepherds us, comforts us, and provides for us is the one owed our thanks and gratitude. In deep humility, let us bring our offerings to God. Will the ushers please come forward?
Thanksgiving and hope. Amen.